Hi, this is Manjula Narayan, Books Editor, Hindustan Times. And today I have with me TM Krishna, who's written this book, Sebastian and Sons, A Brief History of Mrdangam Makers. Well, you know, you're a musician. And but why did you think of doing the mrdangam?
Well, first of all, the makers. I mean, the makers in India in general, the instrument makers are invisible. We don't speak about them. We don't speak about their community, their work, their life, their relationships. And they're completely hidden from the idea of art, right? Mm. So even when I engaged with, for example, social issues in the world of culture and art and wrote about it for years, I never thought of them.
You never thought of them?
I was caste blind. Okay. That's the truth. And I was also blind to what happens behind the scenes, so to speak.
Right? You're saying that it's the reason we don't see the makers is because invariably they're of... not upper caste.
Well, not exactly that way, but many of the times you don't see them because the work they do is not the work that you want to be seen associated with, especially the mrdangam. Because mrdangam involves getting skin from a slaughterhouse. It involves buffalo skin, goat skin, cow skin, and involves treating it, curing it, bringing it to a place where then it produces produces this incredible music. And you want association with that. Beauty and art and, you know, all these things. So invariably, you know, many times, even without even thinking, not necessarily, you know, purposely, but you want all that to remain. In fact, you don't want to talk about it. You don't want to even see it. So even as I'm a Carnatic musician, I've done that all my life. I knew the mrdangam is made by the makers. I knew a few names, but I never bothered about understanding their lives, their history, or simply the magnificence of their workmanship. Because it was not part of the beautiful things that we like to present on stage. It's true of most things we do in life, right? And this hit me one day when I was looking at my first book called Southern Music, in which I speak about, you know, the greatness of art and the complexity and the critique of it. And I speak about society and community and all that, gender and everything. And I realized I had said not a word. In fact, in that whole book, the word really? Instrument maker does not even appear. I say it myself. I wrote it. And it hit me hard. That's when I said...
So at what point did it hit you?
When I was looking at... You know, when you have new editions, you're looking at little changes you're trying to make. It was one of those moments. I was looking at the book again, saying, you know, I want to change this. And I came to the chapter on caste, and there's a huge debate about it. And I said, where is the instrument maker? Where is the mrdangam maker in this? And he was nowhere. So I realized that... an important realization that you have to be constantly, you have to remind yourself of so many things you're blind about. And it may be through habit, it may be consciously, unconsciously. So it hit me. And when it hit me, I said, these are people I need to know about. And I just then started just speaking to them.
Okay. But why the mrdangam? Why not some other instrument?
Yeah, that's a good question. Many people ask me that question. Right? Why not the tanpura? Why not the veena? Why not the veena?
You know, anyway.
It's a very good, I think there are two reasons for it. One is the fact that I knew from the beginning that it involved skin. Mm. And that complicates the relationship even more. Mm. Secondly, you must remember, unlike a tanpura or a veena, when you buy it from a maker, after that you rarely go back to the maker. There's no relationship.
Yes, so you
buy a tanpura, you change the strings yourself most times. Mm. Little bridge work you do. Unless there is something damaged or something, you don't take it back to a maker to help. Mm. So there is no constant relationship. Now, the mrdangam or the tabla or the pakhavaj are very different. Mm. Where the instrument needs constant care, the skin has to be changed. You know, the black spot has to be changed. So there is a constant, intimate, complicated relationship between the maker and the player all through their respective lives.
Okay.
There's an interdependency which cannot be ever given up. That makes this even more interesting as a story. As you know, how does this happen? These are two individuals who normally in life will not have any association. Maybe transactional. You go to a shop or something like that. But here there is both of them and there's a mrdangam in between. And the mrdangam binds them. Right? You take the mrdangam out, those two people are not going to be seeing each other.
That's true.
That's a very, very intriguing complexity. So how does it play out? What does it mean? And, you know, what, you know, the mrdangam player will say, I want this stone. And that's a very abstract idea. The mrdangam maker understands it. That's wisdom. Mm. All this is fascinating.
So there's a real relationship between the maker and the player.
Of course there is.
Throughout their lives.
Of course there is. And it's complex. That's what this book also explores. That the fact is, caste is a very important factor in that relationship. You can't deny it's unusual that a Dalit and a Brahmin are for life bound with each other, because the mrdangam binds them, which means, but they're both in very, very different cultural structures. There is hierarchy here, there's discrimination here, but there is a relationship. So there is a complexity. What is that relationship? What is that? I mean, is it love? Is it affection? Is it feudal? Is it, what is it? So it calls for a great, I think, a lot of nuance of how these negotiations happen. At the same time, also understanding the starkness of how lines are constantly drawn through social markings, which is caste, or it could be gender in another case. And in this case, for example, it's Sebastian and Sons.
Yes.
It's not Sebastian and children, because it's completely a male-dominated profession, right? So all this comes into play in this book.
Okay. But you've also mentioned that there are some female mrdangam makers.
Very
Talk
few.
Talk about that.
So I knew you'll get there first. But so there are very few. First, there are two women who don't make the mrdangam, but are people who basically procure the skin, clean the skin, make it suitable for the mrdangam. That's, in fact, one of the toughest jobs. The two women. One is a woman, and her name is Madamal. She's semi-retired now. Her son does the job. And she lives in a place called Ambur in Tamil Nadu. Ambur is famous for biryani.
Okay.
And the other one is a young girl, a young lady of 35. She lives in a village called Peravamba in near Palakkad.
Okay.
And it's a very fascinating village. It's the village where almost a village of many makers.
Oh, I see.
You know, and you have makers both of chanda and of the mrdangam. And she is one of the big suppliers of skin for these instruments across Kerala.
Okay.
And they were like pretty much the exceptions to what was I generally saw, that women rarely fully made the mrdangam. They participated in the work.
Yeah.
So here is machismo and chauvinism kicking in. So you'll have all the makers saying this is very physical work. It's very hard to do, which is true. You know, women, implying that women cannot do it. But, you know, this black spot on the mrdangam that you see comes out of a mixture of a stone which is powdered and boiled rice.
Okay.
Guess who powders that stone?
Oh,
the women of the house.
Oh.
And it's darn hard to powder that stone.
Yeah,
I mean, it's like banging.
When you are mentioning the stone, stone piece, I was thinking, what stone is it?
Yeah,
it's
so
like
there
granite
is this.
And, you know,
no, this is like a very high ferrous content stone.
Oh.
It's probably, I mean, I did some research. It probably came from magma coming from, so it's volcanic in some
way. Volcanic, okay.
And it's very hard. And that physical work is done by the women. But then we are always told that it's very hard for women to do. You know, it's physically hard, a standard stereotyping.
Mm-hmm.
So you have that happening. So these two women do the skin work. And I think that is one of the reasons why women did not participate.
Okay.
Because it means go to the abattoir.
Oh, I see.
You know, so possibly that was one of the things. And, but these two women supplied. There was one lady from a Brahmin family in Bangalore who makes the mrdangam.
Oh, I see.
So she does the job of putting it together. Now she's very old. Her son does it. Her husband was doing it.
Oh.
Again, very unusual for a Brahmin to do it. There are very few Brahmins who have ever done this job. So, their story is a very different story. So you get that story also, you know, how being actually considered outcast in their family because they did
this
skin-related job and their own struggles with that and their own societal issue. That was also there in the book. And you have this lady who made the mrdangam. So she would not, the skin would come treated and in position, and then she would bind it and do what other makers were doing.
Okay.
So these three are probably the only three women I found who do very serious skin-related work or mrdangam making work. The other women in the family help with stone crushing, drying of the skin at home, things like that.
Okay. And when you describe it, you know, in the first chapter about, you know, binding it, I never thought that it was like so complicated. And, you know, and that a diagram. I just think of the mrdangam. Okay, the mrdangam is there. Somebody's playing it and it sounds great. But all these things, you brought that up.
That's a very important part of the book of respect for knowledge. So how are knowledge systems created? You know, this is one of the things we all need to think about, right? So you never think of, for example, mrdangam making as a knowledge system. It's just taken as something that's put together. Yeah, it's difficult to do, I know it's beautiful, yeah. But those are very trivial words, But you'll never say that about a mrdangam player's playing or a tabla player.
That is true.
Oh, so exquisite, how much effort went into this, how many hours of sadhana they did. We naturally say it.
Yeah.
Do we ever look at a mrdangam maker and say how many hours of sadhana he did? You never do.
Yeah.
But doesn't that say something about us?
Yeah,
but how we build these systems. So a very important part of the book is the entire making process. In fact, in the book, you go through the entire making process. And that was deliberately put in there. Because I felt that the discourse on knowledge systems, on the fact that these people know what stone to pick, if there are 15 kinds of stone on the floor.
And what sort of jackfruit, like
they
you
know,
said.
They
what
know.
Sort of jackfruit
the,
to make
you know,
it
if, I mean, the wood, for example,
jackfruit
is generally jackfruit.
It's generally jackfruit.
Yeah, they all believe that they have tried other things too. But they all believe the best is jackfruit. But they will tell you which part of the tree. There are specific measurements that are kept in mind. Slope, diameter in the center, thickness of the wood. Everything is very specific. Okay? Nothing is accidental. And when they put the layers, when the maker then takes that shell, the shell comes from another place called Panruti. And the community that does the shell is a different community. They buy the shell from them, bring it back. They then get cow skin, goat skin, buffalo skin. The way they place it, how do you choose which goat skin goes to with which cow skin? They touch it and they know it.
My goodness, it's like really complex.
And the way they braid it, there's a system of braiding. How much they pull, how much should you yank it? What is the tension you must have? And you remember that for the mrdangam player. When the player gets on stage, entire circumference has to be in pitch. Even one can't be off pitch. How do you make sure? How do you make sure there's no imbalance? And most importantly, mrdangam making for professionals is individualistic. So if you're a mrdangam player and I'm making it for you, I must know your technique playing. I must know what kind of tone you like. What is the amount of pressure you put
so
on
it's
the skin.
Close relationship. These
that is what
have.
I'm saying makes it fascinating. So the mrdangam player, to a large extent, if you speak to most mrdangam players, they have sustained a relationship with the maker for at least like 10 years, 15 years. And then maybe there's some reason they'll shift. But most relationships are long. So that's what makes it even more intriguing, even more complicated, and even more important for us to understand.
Neurotic also, no?
Yeah, it's very difficult. No? So in the sense that you have, it's a very odd relationship, right? So that's and caste plays such a dominant role. And all these discriminative markers, whether it is gender or caste, makes the person who is being discriminated against also in a way complicit in the whole system. That's what the system does.
Yes.
So then there is each, the person, the mrdangam maker is trying to kind of negotiate a space. The mrdangam player is then drawing lines again. At the same time, there is a need. And the mrdangam player, of course, there is care at some level, but it's also very feudal. So there are lines. So can there be an assertive mrdangam maker?
I'm sure there is.
But assertion is not acceptable. How is assertion acceptable? Because it's like... even today, yeah. So there are... how different is it from feminism and gender?
Mm.
I mean, what kind of assertion from you is acceptable in office space? What kind of assertion is not acceptable in office space?
Yeah, I can't scream.
You know, exactly what I mean.
But then no.
No, but I'm just saying that there are different lines for men.
Yeah. Yeah, that is true.
Men have a different line.
Yeah.
That screaming itself has a different connotation for a man.
That is true.
Yeah, you can't deny. Yeah. So when the same thing operates, right? So I think it's very important to see all this with great nuance. And it's important to see, because most of these systems work in these gaps, which you can't put finger on. It is not like it's not like you're not allowed somewhere or you're said that you, no, that's not where it works. It works in an open office space like here.
Yeah.
You know, and it's all happening in between these conversations, in between these little things that you, for example, you self-censure.
Yes.
Usually the person who's at the receiving end is self-censuring, saying, you know, let's not do that. So all this, in a way, is part of the discourse that I like to bring up.
Okay. Okay. And I found it interesting that you mentioned, you know, the whole thing about how some mrdangam players saying that, oh, they are converts. You know, let's talk about that. Sebastian.
Sebastian
himself.
So, Sebastian in Tamil is Sevettiyan. It's very interesting that all these English names have...
Sevettiyan,
okay. Yeah. And then Fernandez is Parlandu.
Oh, okay.
So, all these are things. So, I was also intrigued, you know, first of all, to find out when they embraced Christianity. And in this book, I kind of come to a vague decision that it's about the late 19th century and early 20th century, probably when they embraced Christianity. Mm. They're all Roman. The one family that you start with are Roman Catholic.
Roman Catholic.
Every other maker is usually Hindu. The makers, Telugu-speaking makers are Hindu. The Malayalis are Hindu. They're all Hindus. But these are, this is the only Christian. And the reason why it's Sebastian is on the title is, in my research, he's probably the oldest full-fledged mrdangam maker I identified.
Okay.
You know, so in a way, he's the first entrepreneur.
Hmm.
And Sebastian and Sons, a little play of upper caste, upper class and Sons entrepreneurship that we have all over this country. So I said, okay, I think we should subvert that because this is entrepreneurship. This is,
yes,
a family business.
Of course it is, yeah.
So we call it Sebastian and Sons. So this whole notion of conversion is a very interesting thing, right? We, especially in today's political environment, there's this necessity that everybody has to say that they're converted. They converted. I never, you know, so how is a white person a natural Christian, but a brown person is a converted Christian? I mean, how does this work? Seriously.
Yeah.
So if you notice that in the beginning of the book, that's always told to me. I always said they were Hindus. So this is very relatable to today's politics and today's environment, where there is always this need for us to say that, you know, Hindu is the original. I know that is the first. Everybody in this country are first Hindus. You know, we go through these, in my opinion, quite ridiculous discussions. They're Christians. They call themselves Christians. That's all matters. But when we ask mrdangam players, they will say, you know, they're converted Christians.
Okay.
So, or they will say, some of them are still Hindus. They still go to temples. You know.
Okay.
That's probably true. But the need to say it is fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
Why is there a need to say it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, but if you go to, you know, it's so beautiful. If you go to any maker's shop, you'll find all gods. You'll find Jesus. You'll find Vinayaka somewhere. You'll find goddess. You'll find Mary. And the maker doesn't see any difference. I think that's where we have to learn from. You know,
mm-hmm.
maker says, I'm Christian, but everybody is there. It's like these auto rickshaws that have
all, yeah,
that,
yeah, all the...
I think that's, we upper caste Hindus don't learn from those pictures. I think we should learn from those pictures because there's no confusion there. That's the beautiful part. No, there's no confusion. Why should we emphasize anything? You know, it's a choice that everybody makes, and let them live by the choices they make.
Hmm. Okay, so now Sebastian's sons have taken over the...
Well, it's sons, grandsons, nephews,
wow.
all relatives. It's like, I mean, there are about four family trees at the end of the book, if you see it. The family tree was the toughest thing to do, especially for the Tanjore family. The Tanjore family has like tertiary branches everywhere.
Oh.
And there are like nephews and extended relatives all in this business now. So it's a huge banyan tree of makers right now. Probably, as far as one family goes, the largest number of makers is from the Tanjore family, Sebastian's and Sons.
Mm.
The other ones are smaller clusters, smaller family groups. Some are, I think, probably towards the end of being in this profession, some of them.
Mm-hmm.
The Kerala family is also quite large, but nothing compared to this. It was mind-boggling for me to get a family tree together because everybody didn't know all the information,
oh,
right? So you're calling multiple members of the family.
Yeah.
And then some people, you just don't know beyond a point. And you must remember that the family tree in this book is only tracing those involved in this business.
Yeah.
So I kept out all the others because I said, you know, otherwise it just...
There's no end to it. You know, and what I found interesting is also how, you know, you brought in history, like the Marathas, you know, coming into Tamil Nadu and all that, you know, even that, the historical and sociological aspects,
yeah,
of all these things, you know.
It's very important, right? Because it's very important to also...
Because, you know, outside Tamil Nadu and maybe Maharashtra, nobody knows.
Yeah, probably. I think that's also a problem.
I
like,
say Ekoji, then who's Ekoji?
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, most people don't know who Ekoji,
yeah,
is. They know he's Shivaji's stepbrother.
Most people
don't even know that.
Yeah.
So it's... I think it's very important. One is in terms of this story and these stories, important to set the context, and that was very important. But it's also important to see the multiple streams that go into cultural platforms.
Yes.
We have also now something that we are completely destroying today. We have made ourselves so, we want a linear story for everything.
Yeah, monocultural.
Completely monocultural, right? So again, that's because of a notion of purity.
Yes.
It entirely comes from building this notion of purity. Mm. So only if this, you only recognize the stream that is going to retain that purity for you. But it doesn't work that way. Every cultural form comes from so many streams, so many different ways of looking at things. So if you look at Carnatic music has influence from everything, from the Christian, from the Islamic, from the Marathas, from the Telugu speaking Nayaks, from the Kannada speaking Nayaks, from the Tamil cultures of Tamil Nadu, from Sanskrit cultures, from Telugu, I mean from Kerala, I mean there's so many things. And you must remember that at one time culture was traveling across
yes,
this country.
That's true. It
from
wasn't like
Delhi to Baroda to everywhere. You know, so I mean, even these making techniques have come from cross-cultural influences.
Yes.
Unfortunately, we're not able to trace that as much as I would have liked to.
Mm.
But definitely a lot of the mrdangam making came from Maharashtra traditions.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's important that we realize these kind of multiple
like sambar
streams.
Being inspired by
It is true. I mean, sambar is very new. Can you even believe sambar was new? No, even I couldn't believe it, right?
I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, but it's relatively new. So I think it's very important we go back to looking at things in that fashion, because it's important that we see that what is there in our constitution of being plural and being secular is actually civilizationally what this land was.
Hmm.
You know, and it is. So it is just our way of looking at democracy and way of looking at constitutional India is only a continuum of that,
mm.
you know. And it's important that we look at all these multiple, you know, beautiful and ugly things, both coexist.
Okay. Okay. And on that note, we shall end. It's a good note to end on. So that's a brief history of mrdangam players, Sebastian and Sons.
Mrdangam makers. You just made the cardinal error.
I did. Mrdangam makers, I'm sorry. Sebastian and Sons by TM Krishna. I'm so happy to have you.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. Thanks.
Bye.